Have you ever felt overwhelmed trying to integrate generative AI into Java projects, only to get frustrated by the fact that all the existing tools are in Python or JavaScript? Or maybe you've spent hours trying to figure out which approach to take. Should you use Spring AI or LangChain for J or do direct RESTful web service calls? Or how about all those new AI agents? What about those? Without knowing which one fits your project the best. First of all, we have Spring AI, the so-called enterprise choice. Here's the Spring AI homepage, and as you might imagine, it's part of the Spring framework. If you or your company are already invested in the Spring ecosystem, Spring AI gives you the most natural integration path. It uses the Spring patterns you already know. It works seamlessly with Spring Boot, Spring Security, Spring Data, all kinds of things. What makes it so powerful? For one thing, you get to use configuration through properties files that you're already accustomed to. Here, for example, is a properties file that has a lot in it, but you don't need all this. These are just optional configuration steps, but you can pick which model you want to use, whether it's from OpenAI or from Claude or from Google's Gemini or Mistral or any of dozens of others. You can pick embedding models. You can configure a vector store using a real database. You can play around with text-to-speech or speech-to-text transcription options. You could set debugging levels, all kinds of things like that. And these are the sorts of things you're already probably doing in a regular Spring Boot application. Next, they have observability and all the normal enterprise features you're accustomed to, which is very helpful. And the observability stuff in Spring is first rate. Now, we also have support for chat and vision and audio and image processing. Notice here, for example, in this test case, you can access individual resources, whether they be prompt templates or images or audio files, whatever you need. And you can auto wire in your chat memory if necessary. You can build up chat clients using various logging mechanisms or chat memory or more. You could do simple queries. You could stream your output and thereby get the pieces back one at a time and work with this asynchronously. You can convert the output into actual records without a problem. That all works just fine. You can embed a prompt template inside, or you could auto-wire it in, as I showed up at the top. You could do vision models by saying, what do you see in this picture, and upload an image to it. You can do that with both local and remote images. You could generate images if you wanted to, even with the latest AI image generation models. You can do excellent tool support working with applications and clients that you enter in. And of course, you can do RAG. You can do retrieval augmented generation and use a question answer advisor and chat memory to ask questions of your own documents and other resources. You also have support for Spring profiles and all the normal features inside of Spring. Spring AI is really good for teams that already have an investment in the Spring framework. That could be individuals or companies. And if you want enterprise-ready AI features, Spring AI recently went to version 1.0. It is ready to go. But what if you're not locked into Spring and you still need state-of-the-art AI capabilities? That's where our second alternative comes in, LangChain for J. So our second pillar is LangChain for J, which is basically the AI toolkit for real-world Java projects that don't necessarily use Spring or do use Spring, but not Spring AI. LangChain for J is the most flexible toolkit for building powerful AI applications in Java, no matter what stack you're using for the rest of your system. What sets it apart? The tool support is phenomenal. You can expose any Java method you want as a tool that large language models can invoke just by annotating that method with that tool. LangChain for J is easy. It has production-ready support for RAG. It has the great tool support mechanisms and built-in integration for vector stores, document retrievers, and everything. But one of my favorite features of LangChain for J is what they call AI services. The idea in AI services is that you can simply define an interface, and then LangChain4j will implement that interface for you using the chat model that you provide, and you can then automatically call whatever methods you added to the interface. You can return strings, you can return objects, you can have streaming responses come back. It does all this work on your behalf, and it's really nice. LangChain4j, like Spring AI, is model agnostic. There are many language models available inside here. So you could see the ones that are web-based are in here, as well as Anthropic and good old ChatGPT, GitHub models, Gemini, Hugging Face models, open source models that way, open source models via Ollama. You've got Mistral, you have OpenAI. It goes on and on. Lots of options there. This also works just fine with other frameworks. Like I mentioned, Spring, but you can incorporate LangChain4j in a Quarkus system or Micronaut or Helidon, or you could just use it as a standalone library. It's also a very convenient way to work with multiple AI models together. For example, in this particular project, I have the OpenAI models and Mistral and Gemini and Ollama and Claude all in the same application. And it's easy enough to just load them all up individually and use them one by one. In fact, I have Perplexity and DeepSeek in this application as well. And there's no problem having the output of one model being fed into the input of the next. They all work together very comfortably. LangChain4j is perfect for developers who want to integrate AI tool use as well, so that large language models can call your own business logic or external APIs. For example, here's a date time tool that allows the AI model to find out how many years something happens in the future based on the current date, not on when its training data ended. You provide this trivial little method and annotate it with that tool and tell the large language model about it, and it uses it. Now, this was so convenient and so easy that, frankly, the Spring AI people decided to adopt this mechanism, changing their entire structure just because they saw how nice this was. So that's another reason to favor this. And it could be very powerful stuff. You can use RESTful web services like this one, which accesses open exchange rates online and provides a conversion utility. And then you just ask, hey, compare these prices, which are in different units. What do you think? And it'll automatically do all the conversions for you. Just as with Spring AI, you can load in your own documents from the file system or from remote. You can create an in-memory embedding store or a remote one. You can process all this information into a content retriever and store everything in a vector data store and ask whatever queries you want. Works out beautifully. If you're building real-world AI apps in Java and you want both power and flexibility and you are not necessarily tied to the Spring ecosystem, LangChain4j is really the best choice. Now let's move to the third pillar, direct integration with RESTful web services. This will give you maximum control and also allow you to do things that the frameworks either don't do or don't do yet. Tools that are too new or features that have been added that are not yet available within the frameworks. This gives you the ability to get under the hood and do things your way, providing what you need. So understanding direct AI integration not only gives you that ultimate flexibility and helps you implement features before they're available in the frameworks, but it also tells you what the frameworks are trying to do. So you understand how they work and what to do when they go wrong. Now, ultimately, from a Java point of view, these AI models are simply RESTful web services. That means in order to access them, we need a networking library and we need a way to produce and parse JSON data, JavaScript object notation. So in order to work with this, you need some foundational skills. For the networking library, you use the HTTP client and HTTP request. You wind up sending this, and then all you need after that is a way to parse the results. So if you're going to parse and generate JSON data, what do you do with that? Java's got two excellent open source libraries that you can use and are worth learning. One is the Jackson library used inside Spring, and the other is JSON, the one that mostly is used inside LangChain for J, although I think they're using Jackson in more and more places as well. You can use whichever one you want. If you use the Jackson library, you can return your information as a JSON node, and then there's a very simple at method that allows you to walk the tree as easily as you would in Python or JavaScript. That's the thing. Java doesn't have a built-in parser for these things, but that doesn't mean the libraries can't do it in case you want to. So for example, here looking at DeepSeek, and DeepSeek has that reasoning content inside it, and that's not part of the built-in models. So what can you do? Just get back a JSON node and use the at method, and you could just walk the tree. This is actually going to choices, the first choice, the message, and then inside the message, the reasoning content, and you can get at it directly. So it's very easy to work with all of these individual tools. So another mechanism you could use is you could always map the output to Java records and just work with records directly. And records are incredibly easy to write, and they map directly to JSON data. It's very simple. And if you're struggling with how to map everything to records, that's what the AI tools are for. For example, I could paste in this JSON structure, which I got from the Perplexity API, and just say, how do you map this to Java records? And it spits out your query response with a list of image and a list of result, and there's the image record and there's the result record. And then the AI will even tell you how to work with it with Jackson. And you could just use this code directly. It's very straightforward. Direct REST access is perfect when you need cutting edge features or complete control of what you're doing, or you really want to understand what's happening under the hood. It's always a good thing to know how these things are working, even if you later decide to use a framework. The thing that's happened most recently that has had the biggest impact on our industry has been the rise of these AI agents. What if you want the AI to not just help you with code, but actually write and modify it all for you? That brings us to our fourth pillar, AI agents. Your coding assistants. AI agents can read, understand, and modify your code base directly once you give them permission. Instead of dealing with a single class at a time, the agent can see your entire project and can explain what's going on in the project, can come up with documentation for it. With some Git integration, it could make commit messages and commit the code to Git, or analyze issues that come in and suggest ways to implement them. It can write test cases and make sure that the tests are all passing before committing the results to your CI server. It really is like having an AI paired programmer with you that never gets tired. Now, in IntelliJ, that brings us to, for example, Juni, which allows you to delegate your tasks and focus on the results. And you could ask it like, please describe this project, something very simple here, and it will formulate a plan and determine what sorts of answers you want to give and will eventually return a result. The plan here is to examine the Gradle build file, look at key classes in the AI model file, look in the README, understand the package structure, work through the test cases, and compile some sort of comprehensive description of the project based on all the findings. You can watch it work with each individual file here, see all of them being used one by one. When it does terminal applications, like looking in the directory, you could always open that up and see what commands it's actually executing. And eventually you get a response after it examines everything. Sometimes those responses are written in markdown files, which you could then edit. This one's basically just giving us a high-level description, and you can go on from there. Other tools are like Claude Code, which work from the command line. You could also connect that to your IDE, for example. If I say IDE here, it'll say, oh, you're using IntelliJ. Do you want to use that? And I'll say, sure. And now whatever code modifications it makes will show up in IntelliJ as undoable modifications there. You could ask questions like, what improvements do you suggest for this project? and have it think about that and give you advice and suggestions. Again, I mentioned you could have it access your GitHub repository. It also works very nicely with MCP tools, the Model Context Protocol, so that you could work with any external tool that provides MCP support. Whenever it has to do something that involves a command on the command line, you could say, sure, go do that, give it permissions, but it won't do anything that you don't allow it to do. Like here, it's going to run Gradle tests, which I've already approved. One tip I'm going to bring up in the individual video for this is to point out that whenever you're working with one of these AI agents, be sure that your project is under source code control and always create a new branch before you allow the agent to do anything. It's the easiest way to undo any changes once the tools get a little overenthusiastic, as they sometimes do. So AI agents are perfect for accelerating your development cycle and handling any repetitive code tasks. So how do you move forward? Each of these approaches has a place in the modern Java developer's toolkit. And in the upcoming videos, we'll do a deep dive into each of them. We'll do a Spring AI deep dive. Then with LangChain for J, we'll look at the tool support and how it does RAG applications and more. With Direct REST Mastery, we'll talk about working with the HTTP client and JSON or JSON as parsers and what you can do manually there. And finally, we'll look at AI agents and survey the state of the art and see what seems to work particularly well and particularly poorly with Java. What should you start with? I'd say if you're new to AI and Java and you have an investment in the Spring framework at all, then go ahead and go with Spring AI. It's going to be the default choice for most Spring-based developers because it's just another starter you add to your build file. If you're not a Spring person or you don't want to be constrained to Spring, then LangChain for J is an absolutely wonderful alternative. I really like it. It's a remarkably stable API and very powerful and has everything you need. If you want maximum flexibility and you want to understand what a lot of these tools are doing under the hood, then learn about the Direct REST integration. Learn about your networking tools and about JSON parsing with Java and generation as well. And if you're ready to accelerate your coding a lot, then explore these AI agents as well. So please subscribe so you don't miss any of the future videos in this series, the ones that are going to give you the tips and all of these different topics. And in the comments, let me know which pillar you're most excited to learn about. And that'll help me prioritize which deep dive to produce first to make sure that I give you the ones that you're actually looking for. If you're already using AI in your Java projects, please share what's working for you and what challenges you're facing. I'm going to fill these videos with as many tips and tricks as I can, but I only know my own experience and the experience of people I've talked to and the research I've done. If you have faced a particular issue or something unique, I'd love to hear about it. Your experience will help shape the examples I use in the upcoming videos. Until then, good luck and happy coding.